caucus results are expected, allegedly, later today, but every campaign is fuming over both the DNC's mishandling of last night and, of course, the lack of transparency.
In a heated call with the Iowa Democratic Party, representatives for each campaign, they demanded answers. It was so testy that the Iowa Democratic Party actually hung up on a conference call with the campaigns. Here to weigh in on all of this is Michael Brooks. He's host of The Michael Brooks Show. He's returned gallantly to the stage.
That's right. He looks good on our set.
How are you doing? One thing I want to focus on, we're talking about this on the break, which is that some preliminary data, again, we don't have any real data. The most we have is from a campaign that has an interest in probably spinning it their way. But it seems that Bernie Sanders may not have increased beyond in his second alignment, basically was not able to pick up as much second choice support as a Pete Buttigieg. What really has resulted in Pete even having the ability to try and claim victory is that. Why do you think that is? So much of what I heard from the Sanders people, and you're a Sanders supporter yourself, is that he has this ability to expand the diverse coalition, bring in people. Why didn't that materialize, Michael?
Well, I think what's interesting is that the dynamic has flipped, and a lot of the numbers indicate that he has the capacity to increase the coalition in places that actually have a much more diversity, frankly, than Iowa.
So like a Nevada or
South Carolina. Nevada or California. So I think the kind of narrative has actually flipped in terms of the base that he's growing and how. So that would be, you know, one part of my genuine answer. The second part, if those numbers hold, that's concerning.
Yeah.
I mean, on the other hand, how much can we just start to bracket that Iowa is bizarre? That Pete is able to overperform because of geography and dumping a massive amount of money.
Get a huge amount of money.
I mean, I also just don't want to get ahead of the data. I was looking at what the Sanders campaign put out, which again, there's an interest in it being favorable to them, and this is only 40% of precincts reporting. But actually, Elizabeth Warren had an issue in terms of bringing people over as well, according to this data. Pete was really the only person who grew significantly, but Sanders also grew between the first count and the final count, and ultimately the person who gets the most gets to win. So we'll see where this all goes before we draw too many elaborate conclusions about this. But if it does hold that it's basically Bernie, Pete, 1-2, Warren, and then Biden, which is what it looks like it's going to end up being. We don't know for sure, but that's what it looks like it will end up being. How do you feel about that as a Sanders supporter?
Well, going back to last night, I feel good. I like the idea of running against Pete. And I actually think that if I'm Bloomberg, I'm annoyed because there's this new surge of interest in what really is just not a credible national candidate as of yet. Maybe that will change. But I don't see Pete Buttigieg running across the country and running in multiple states and being able to have compelling answers for any of the just many, many, many problems in his record, from race to corporate consulting. I think part of the reason Bloomberg went in is people around Bloomberg are like, wait a second, you're a right-wing, you know, quote-unquote Democrat with a problematic record, and you ran New York City, and you're a billionaire.
And you have $50 billion.
And you're an oligarch. Who the hell is this little guy? Get in there. But now he just had a great performance. I think that paralyzes the sort of corporate coalescing candidate.
Here's the other interesting data point, which is this, you know, again, who knows what we can trust out of Iowa. The turnout seems to only have been around 172,000, not the 250,000. Right. Bernie said himself the night before the caucus, he said, if turnout's low, I'm going to lose. If turnout's high, I'm going to win. Seems to have been a bit low, Michael. Why do you think that is? We've been speculating as to many answers. I personally think that it's impeachment. I think impeachment coverage made it so that people were fed up with the process. Democrats didn't feel really enthusiastic. The last time around, all they were talking about health care. And another possibility is there were just too many candidates. Is that they were like, you know, I can't pick.
There's, tyranny of choice kind of thing. I mean, but that's one that I just don't even have a ground to speculate on, I feel like, right? That really confuses me. It seems to me, though, that there is a positive way of spinning it, and that would be that if it turns out he won, which it looks like he did, and they didn't really drive up those numbers, that's actually a very positive signal in a way. And then I think, you know, going into other places like New Hampshire or South Carolina or California, I mean, I know a lot of people in California have already started voting and have been kind of really hitting doors. It's easier to tell somebody, all right, I want you enrolled in this process. You need to go and vote, and here's how you do it. Mm-hmm. Versus, all right, you need to go to a gymnasium. There's going to be a bunch of weird people talking to you.
Yeah.
Then you have to talk to some other people.
Right.
Then somebody's going to have a coin toss. I mean, this is another step in how odd this process is.
And for working people, especially, or first-time caucus goers, or working people with kids, I mean, this is a ridiculous, impossible process. Voting is already hard enough the way that we do it in normal circumstances. Yeah. It's just completely anti-democratic. Not to mention, if you're a worker there and your boss is there and you've got to publicly declare who you're supporting, it's really, we should just not be doing this anymore.
Yeah,
this is not a democratic system. If we saw it happening in another country, we'd be like, this is unacceptable. Here's my question for you, though. Biden had a bad night. I mean, by all indications, his own team is, like, downplaying expectations, saying they don't think he did very well. They're trying to spin that maybe we can't rely on the results. And, by the way, let's just focus on whatever states come next, et cetera, et cetera. He doesn't have much money in the bank. What is his path? What do you think he needs to do in New Hampshire? Would you count him out?
I mean, this I've been someone who's been pretty, like, opposed to counting him out. I thought that there was
We have been here, too.
I agree with you guys. I thought there was a certain resiliency and him as a default choice. But you go into New Hampshire where he is not polling well, and the sad part of this is I'll go rain on Biden all day for civil rights, for Iraq, for bankruptcy bill, for trade. And as a comedian, I will joke about his deterioration. But as a human being, and this is just depressing, I don't think he has the capacity, frankly, to do what you would need to do. I mean, this campaign does not, it looks like they're sort of marching an older person around who isn't capable to do what they're asking him of. So I don't mean that as an insult. I actually find it very sad in human moments to watch this, frankly. I don't see it.
I don't disagree. I mean, again, waiting on the final results, but if he underperformed his polls by a 6-7% margin, that is crazy. That is like, A, it's a massive polling error, and B, I mean, it just shows that there's a lot of stuff. It was a much softer support than we thought. I guess the final real question here is that how are you thinking about Elizabeth Warren? Because if we have this as a Warren, Pete, Bernie race, what do you make of Warren in that particular dynamic?
Well, I don't like Warren very much. and I think if she was, you know, as someone who on the left, I think in 2016, though my politics are Bernie's, I mean, she was the one to coalesce around to go against Clinton. After 2016, it's clearly Bernie going into 2020. I think, though, that you have a scenario where New Hampshire looks very favorable for Bernie. I don't suspect she'll do well in Nevada or South Carolina, so this could be her high tide.
Yeah.
Now, clearly, if it's a three-person race going in, she'll lean into that unity argument. But I don't see, I think it's the same dynamic with Pete. I just don't really see her growing her base.
I don't see it either, but it is interesting.
Yeah, I feel like New Hampshire, especially with the, you know, home state, neighboring state advantage there, if she can't put up good numbers there and be at least in second place, I think the road looks very, very challenging for her. Michael, thank you so much for being with us last night.
Pleasure.
Thank you for being back with us today. It's great to have you here.
Good to see you, man. Next on Rising, what in the world happened last night in Iowa? Team Rising shares their thoughts on the caucus that produced no definitive results. That's all.